perfect world, I could review Dr. Sleep without ever mentioning The Shining, but it's not a perfect world, so I'm going to start where everyone must start with these reviews. The Shining is a film that I adore. I watch often, and I think overall is one of the top films ever made in the horror genre. It's also a deeply flawed film at the same time, and the horror genre is one of the few places where those are not mutually exclusive. Consider, too, that the Stephen King of today was not the Stephen King of 1979. King was definitely known, but he was not the first and last name of horror fiction. So adapting and changing The Shining was something that Kubrick, even if he hadn't been Stanley Kubrick, would probably be willing to do. So why so many years later come back to The Shining? Well, King did, with a novel called Dr. Sleep. So what I'm going to try and do here is to review Dr. Sleep on its own merits, but it's impossible to do so without also discussing that the third act of Dr. Sleep does not work at all without The Shining. This movie has been receiving some absolutely outstanding reviews, and there are definitely outstanding sequences in the film. The first astral projection sequence is, in my mind, a modern filmmaking marvel, and it's certainly more impressive than most anything I've seen as far as the special effects sequence in years. It has a certain magic to it that I would compare with something like Spielberg back in his prime. But outstanding is only part of the film. The film is also at turns very good, good, less than good, and in a few moments, and some of those moments are pretty crucial moments, pretty awful. So, as much as I'd like to give an overall impression of the film as one thing, it's kind of impossible to do so. One of the difficulties in reviewing this film also is not knowing exactly how much blame to put on the source material and unwillingness to change from the source material. Most of this film's problems lie in the impossible task handed to it. It had to be all at once an adaptation of the novel Dr. Sleep. It needed to be a sequel to The Shining, the novel, and a sequel to The Shining, the movie. And all three of those properties are very different.
So what did Mike Flanagan do? A tightrope walk. And mostly, he pulled it off.
I've not seen another film with a more clear three-act structure in quite a long time, which is a stark contrast to Kubrick's take. Here's the big win for the film, though. Most sequels are very content to simply repeat themselves. This does not. For most of the runtime, this is its own animal, and it's a film that had a few characters' names changed, you wouldn't identify with The Shining property at all. And that's when the film's at its best, by the way. When the actors are allowed to run and the filmmakers are allowed to develop their own distinct style and sensibilities. The first act of the film threatens to become a film classic. It is pretty excellent with very, very, very few missteps at all. The second act gets a little wobbly, and then the third act gives us the majority of our problems. When the film feels an obligation to repeat some sequences from the original Shining and have a lot of fan service added. Now, fan service is a complex thing. It's not always bad. The question is why? Are you repeating images just to get a reaction out of the audience, or are you furthering your story through the audience remembering the earlier film? Here, it's a mixture of the two, and there's certain sequences that work, some that don't. Some go on too long, and some could have been beefed up. Unlike the beginning of the film, whereas I wanted to spend more time in that world, by the end I was ready to be done. The recreation of The Shining that you saw in Ready Player One is more convincing than what you see here. Recasting actors from the original film with new actors isn't really the problem. The first act has characters from the original film recast, and it plays really well. At the end, it doesn't work as well because there's not as much goodwill. And some of the actors are unfortunately kind of mugging for the camera and doing pantomime of the classic performers. This sounds like I didn't like the film, but the truth is I did like the film. I'm just a little bit baffled by the reviews that are calling it a classic and a masterpiece. It's not that. It was handed an impossible task, and it pulls off that task remarkably well. But at the same time, it does make its share of mistakes that prevent it from being thought of in the same breath as Stanley Kubrick's classic. There are certain logic problems throughout the movie, and I don't want to get into spoilers, but I'll just say that certain times characters make really dumb decisions. And that would be fine if the characters were not smart characters, or characters that in an earlier scene hadn't pointed out what a mistake it would be to do exactly what they do. It almost seems like the filmmakers had decided, well, we're gonna let this one go. We know this scene's goofy, but we really want to get this set piece in place. And that's something that is hard to imagine Stanley Kubrick have ever done with The Shining. His film feels organic and like a whole piece of art. It feels almost like a painting, really, albeit a garish and sometimes overbearing painting. Dr. Sleep never tries to imitate the style of that film, and that's a smart move. Unfortunately, when it comes to the end of the film, it's forced to do so because it's repeating set pieces from the original. And that's really a big mistake. Now, we've dealt with a lot of bad remakes and a lot of bad late sequels, so it's easy to see why people would be preferring this to those, but I'm judging it just on its own. And here's the thing. The film asks us to judge it on its own, repeatedly, by simply being different and going places you wouldn't expect. It refuses to be a haunted house story. Until, of course, it needs to be a haunted house movie. So where do I ultimately stand on Dr. Sleep? Well, I think you should go see it. It's worth supporting, and it's worth drawing your own conclusions about. But unlike The Shining, which so many years later we're still seeing people dissect and decide what it means, people are more or less deciding if this works. And I don't see a day when this film sees as many interpretations. It's pretty much a straight-up horror film, based on a pretty straight-up horror novel. It suffers where it suffers, and it succeeds where it succeeds. I do wish it wasn't quite so mechanical in its setup of every major plot point. A good example of what I mean is in Die Hard 2, we have a close-up of a lighter that is used at the end of the film. That kind of heavy-handedness is all over this movie, when every time we need something later to happen, we'll give a clear indication of it earlier in the film to show to the audience, hey, remember this, it'll be important later. There's a bit too much of that to think that we're ever dealing with a classic film. It's more like a programmer. And as a sequel to a classic film, that's a hard pill. But maybe it's easiest to review this film a different way. The Exorcist is a classic film, no matter if you're going to say a classic horror film or just a classic film. It's never really had a sequel that's really lived completely up to it, but it does have a film that's a completely different story, and that's Exorcist 3. And that film, pound for pound, I think is as good a film. It's just a different film. Dr. Sleep should be the Exorcist 3 to The Shining's Exorcist. It doesn't quite get there, but it's not the straight-up sequel that you'd expect, and that should be admired. Overall, I encourage you to go check this film out and make your own decisions about it. Some of you are going to love it. Some of you are going to probably be pretty repulsed by it. And there won't be an easy mix of, well, Kubrick fans will like or dislike it, or fans of the book will like or dislike it. I think it's going to be a really wild mix of reactions. For myself, I didn't react all that much, to be honest with you. I was never bored with the movie, but I saw it as kind of a regular movie. And The Shining isn't a regular movie. I wish I could review this film as just its own thing. It's just too hard to do that. So, go see it, make your own decisions about it, leave your comments on how you felt about the film below.